behind the stage right before we walked out to perform, I just started thinking about how unexpected this experience was to me.
Then there's always that moment right before the performance starts where you try to stay centered, and yet our body and mind can tell us otherwise. My grandmother, Celina Biniaz, is a survivor of the Holocaust. She was a Schindler's List survivor, was put on the list by Schindler, along with her father and her mother.
I was liberated from Oskar Schindler's factory in Czechoslovakia on the 9th of May, 1945. I was on his list, and that is how I survived.
Growing up, I never knew about her history.
He knew that I was a survivor, but he didn't really know the whole story.
And I think it was a very good decision to leave me unaware of this.
And when he started working at Shoah, he went into the archives and saw the testimony, not only of my testimony, but my mother's testimony.
Getting to see both of their stories once working at the foundation was incredibly meaningful. And I was given a much greater sense historically of what was going on at the time in their lives than I ever knew before. She's so full of life. She's a student to this day, and she takes classes today. We've compared classes and what we're taking, and to be active in the world as a community member that she's been for the last 60 years since her experiences in the Holocaust, it inspires me every day. In May of 2014, the USC Shoah Foundation hosted the Ambassadors for Humanity Gala. And my grandmother, on behalf of the Jewish survivors community, was asked to speak. And the award recipient for that year of the Ambassador for Humanity was the President of the United States, Barack Obama.
I would have never believed that my experiences in camps and at Schindler's Factory would ever be written up in a fabulous book, or that this incredible movie would be made, Schindler's List, or that I would ever be talking to a huge audience like that in the presence of the President of the United States.
I'm a senior studying neuroscience and piano performance at the University of Southern California. I started playing piano at a very young age, at 4 and a half. And so it's always been with me. Music and neuroscience, there's definitely a lot of overlap. The way that music makes people feel interests me very much. I really would love to study more about why music can bring people to tears, for example. So 2 summers ago, I took a research trip to Rwanda. Well, Rwanda is a very beautiful country, but a very, very dark history to it. Once you start talking to the people, you realize that genocide really affects them each and every day, even today. My project, I was really interested in how to best facilitate trauma recovery. Music serves as kind of an opportunity to process and express trauma in a way that bypasses language itself. So we both are interns at the USC Shoah Foundation, and as part of that, we often use the Visual History Archive to watch testimony and write about it and think about it and use it in different ways. This project, Melodies in Auschwitz, kind of was born out of the archive itself because of the huge trove of musical performance that's held within it.
This musical presence helped them as people survive.
Drawing inspiration on some of the melodies that we found that were performed or written in Auschwitz from the survivors, we were able to start composing what became our piano suite.
So for us, it was trying to combine traditional Jewish melody with our contemporary view on it.
We would get together and kind of just play around a little bit. And so like I would be playing like a melody and some kind of some harmonies that might go well with it. And then, you know, all of a sudden, Alex would have this great idea of maybe like a bass line that would just add a lot of depth to it. One of the first melodies that we encountered was from an Italian Jewish survivor. Her name was Lucia Matto. And she used a traditional Yiddish melody, but set her own text to it.
Qui in questa terra, triste maledetta, soffrono molti figli di Israele.
Now, from Lucia's melody, we wanted to use something in the context of pre-Holocaust Europe. And for people like Lucia, life was probably good. And we thought, in the context of a dance, with people enjoying themselves and laughing, that the waltz was a great way of conveying this emotion.
So I started by writing the first movement, which is titled Exodus. And it represents how just normal people living their daily lives were basically ripped away from everything they knew and sent to Auschwitz in this very forceful manner. To convey in a musical way what people would have felt as they walked off the train once it arrived at Auschwitz, that sinking, crushing feeling of seeing the most horrendous sight in front of you, having your loved ones just torn away, we decided to directly represent that on the keys by walking down from high to low.
The second movement I entitled Ashes to Earth. It represents the visual image of inmates arriving at the camp and seeing ashes as they come in, billowing out of the chimneys of the crematoria. It had to represent something that was cyclical. This wasn't just a one-time thing, this was constant.
Another melody that really inspired us is from a song that survivor Wolf Dean listened to as a young man when he's in the Lodz ghetto in Poland. And this melody is very slow and somber, and for me represents really what it would feel like to be not in control of your own future.
Ghetto, getunia, ghetto na kochana, which means ghetto, little ghetto, my beloved little ghetto.
The last movement was more of a collaborative epping because it grew organically, and we entitled it Inner Refractions. The reason that we chose Inner Refractions was that survivors left the camp a little bit hollowed out, and they had to reconceptualize the world and what it meant to them. And so these refractions are meant to be sort of hollow ghosts, and the ghosts exist within all survivors and within the camp as well. January 27th, 2015 was the 70th anniversary of the liberation of Auschwitz concentration camp.
In a few years' time, our generation won't have any direct access to survivors who actually lived through that experience. So the moment we found out we were going to be traveling to Poland to perform this piece, we were understandably pretty excited.
And it was an incredible feeling knowing that the work paid off and that we'd have this chance to play for survivors and communicate with them the message that we had tried to develop over the months.
We were looking over the plans of how the stage was going to be set up and everything like that, and we quickly realized that the stage was not going to be able to support the weight of two full grand pianos, and told to basically reduce our entire two-piano suite into a one-piano work for four hands. We were going to have to do a lot of rewriting and condensing in order to delineate the parts, so that we weren't constantly jutting into each other.
And we were changing the piece up until the hours before the performance.
Through the whole condensing process, the piece matured in a way that it really couldn't have if we hadn't been told that we had a week to kind of rewrite the entire thing for one piano.
It's kind of a surreal moment right now. I still think the thrill hasn't hit yet. I think once we land in Europe, it's going to start feeling much more real. But I'm incredibly excited. This is going to be it. We're about to embark on a pretty incredible journey.
That's right. Got our passports. Got our music.
Let's go. Here we are, finally here, standing in the old square in not-so-sunny Krakow. And we are getting excited for tomorrow morning.
That's the moment when it hits you, like, this is real life, this is happening. When they tell you, you're on in 5 seconds.
The piece that we wrote tells this story of the Holocaust in kind of a non-traditional way. So through the medium of music, I hope that people are able to listen to it and, knowing a little bit of background information, kind of emotionally connect with the subject matter.
Music is really the one true universal language, in that across all boundaries, across all cultures and language, we will all be able to understand these melodies and interpret it in the way that we'd like. Music has that ability to keep life going. And I think it's our duty as young people to educate other young people about the ills of genocide.
We, the survivors, who are now in our 80s and 90s, have definitely passed the torch to the new generation.
And so it's important to raise awareness about what happened and to keep fresh in our memories that this type of thing could happen again. And it really does go even beyond anti-Semitism. And in a way, it's trying to help rid the world of all forms of baseless racial and ethnic intolerance. The fact that we were able to contribute to that message in such a personal way through music is really incredible.
To see Auschwitz at night lit up with people walking around with candles, I just thought it was such an incredible experience for him, and I was glad that he had that experience. In terms of listening to him play, that was fantastic. I mean, every grandmother would love to have a grandson play.
I'm a proud grandma today. But I knew for her that it was so emotional coming back to this awful place. And I could feel it, even though I know that a lot of these emotions she had wrapped up for a long time after the war. She was finally able to let all the ghosts go away.
Out of the ashes of Auschwitz, there is a new generation.